Good morning, everyone. Welcome to All Souls Unitarian Church. My name is Greg Sanders, and I'm the music director here at the church and also your technical director for the services. Thank you for joining us today. Last night, I watched the film Call Me By Your Name, which I had seen before, but I hadn't watched for a while. And I remembered how great that soundtrack is. So earlier today, we were listening to some music by Sufjan Stevens. He's wrote several songs for that. And then it also has all this gorgeous piano music by Maurice Ravel. It's just a great movie. If you haven't seen it, I highly recommend it. At any rate, today we welcome guest minister Viola Abbott. She is from Virginia Beach, Virginia. She and Reverend Joel are doing a swap today. So we're excited to have her with us. Our worship associate is Sandy Ryberg, and they're going to be leading you through the service. A couple of things, if you have any questions, please reach out to me on the chat. I'm happy to help you. We advise you to stay muted. Do not make us silence your voices. Also, we ask that you, or we recommend that you stay in speaker view so you can see who's supposed to be talking. But if you choose gallery view, you can sort of check out everybody else that's here, but speaker view is usually the best way to do it. You'll also want to be able to see the slides because we have the lyrics to our hymns that way, and we invite you to participate. Thank you for joining us. Have a great weekend. If you need anything else, please let me know. Enjoy the service. Here is Viola with our opening words.
Good morning, everyone. The opening words I have selected for this morning are by Judith Quarles, Meditation for Beginning. Spirit of life and love, in this season of beginning, some of us are hurried and harried. Some of us feel sorrowful and afraid. Some of us are not yet ready to step forward into the future. May we minister to one another with wisdom, meeting our friends with open ears, open eyes, and open hearts. In this season of beginning, some of us are celebrating triumphs and joys. Some of us feel whole and happy. Some of us are eager and excited, curious to see what happens next. Let us each, as we are able, take part in one another's happiness and enthusiasm. Quiet spirit of life and love, bring us the grace to share wholly and faithfully in the lives of our friends and loved ones. Amen.
Good morning and welcome to All Souls Unitarian Church of Indianapolis. I am Sandy Reed Ryberg, serving today as the worship associate for our virtual service that we continue to offer during the ongoing COVID pandemic. We welcome you and invite you to bring with you this morning your whole self and all of your lived experience as you join us in worship. For us, worship means finding together that which we value and is of worth to us. Our congregation is united by our covenant, which we will repeat in a few moments as we light our chalice. You can find more about our beliefs on our website at allsoulsindy.org. These beliefs are reflected in our primary goal of putting love into action. Today, our interim minister, Reverend Joel Miller, has exchanged pulpits with Reverend Viola Abbott, who is currently the minister at Coastal Virginia Unitarian Universalist Congregation in Virginia Beach, Virginia. Reverend Abbott is currently serving also as a member of the Unitarian Universalist Ministers Association's Committee on Anti-Racism, Anti-Oppression, and Multiculturalism. She also serves on the Journey Toward Wholeness Transformation Committee of the UUA and on the board of UU Wellspring Incorporated. We welcome you, Reverend Abbott. Please join me in repeating our covenant as Savvy Kennedy lights our chalice in honor of her birthday on Friday. Happy birthday, Savvy. Love is the spirit of this church, and service is its law. To dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another. This is our covenant.
Please join us in singing our opening hymn. We're going to start our service today with the song, There's a River Flowing in My Soul. Thank you.
You're muted, Sandy.
Thought I clicked it, sorry. Our Unitarian Universalist congregation is in the middle of many different processes right now. We are in the middle of our annual pledge campaign led by Rick and Mary May, and I encourage you to help us move closer to the end of that campaign by being sure to make your pledge as soon as possible of annual support if you have not already done so. We are in the middle of cleaning our church so that we can be ready to return to gathering in person. We are in the middle of Reverend Miller's first year of a 2-year term serving as our interim minister. We are at the beginning, though, of the process of seeking a permanently hired senior minister to lead our congregation forward for many years to come. I've been part of the All Souls Indianapolis congregation since birth, so I've been through this process a few times. And in my opinion, we've always gotten it right. I have loved and appreciated every minister I have known here, which includes all but one since 1948. Yes, that's when I was born. They were human, so none was perfect, but during each minister's tenure, we have grown and changed as a congregation and have continued to help move the arc of the universe toward justice through our efforts, even when we've made mistakes in those efforts. I've been so thankful to be able to contribute to saving our planet from the possibly disastrous effects of climate change, to work toward advancing the role of women in the decisions that affect our lives, to enable everyone to be able to marry the person they love, and to make equality for people of all ethnic, gender, sexual, and racial identities a reality and not just a dream. Of course, none of these goals has been fully reached, but change has happened in my lifetime, change that I can see, describe, and celebrate. As we hear today from Reverend Abbott on the theme of becoming and about how that process often goes in our lives, I plan to apply what I hear to thinking about what All Souls Unitarian Church might become in future years. We are in charge of that, no matter whom we choose to lead us in that process of becoming. May we choose thoughtfully and in the spirit of love. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Sarah Cannon, and I'm our Director of Children's and Community Programming. And I'm so excited this morning because our April Soul Matters theme is becoming, and some of y'all already came piling out of faith formation to tell me all about it. I love using Soul Matters because we have adults, youth, and children who are all exploring the same theme at the same time. In fact, there are UUs across the country who are all using the Soul Matters themes. I am always happy about things that draw UUs closer together. But let me tell you something else about the Soul Matters themes. They're not just that one word. The theme word is kind of a fill in the blank for a sentence. What does it mean to be a people of becoming? I really, really love this way of looking at themes, and this month's theme in particular, because I think becoming is one of our most important theological words. Theological, by the way, means about theology. And if I haven't bent your ear about the word theology before, here's the scoop. Theology comes from two different Greek words, theos and logos. Theos means God and logos means word. So basically theology means words about God. Pretty simple, right? We use our words to explain what we believe. So theology words are also belief words. Here are a few of the words about God we use at UU churches. Atheist, someone without God, meaning someone who doesn't believe in any higher powers. Agnostic, someone without knowledge about God, meaning a person who's not sure whether a higher power exists or not. And then, of course, there's a theist, someone who believes in God. These are all theologies. So whether you believe in a higher power or whether you don't, you have a theology. You probably have one, even if you don't remember thinking about it before. It's inside you somewhere, but you might not have named it yet. Now, here's the tricky part. These definitions are pretty simple, but each of them can look a lot of different ways. For example, a theist might believe in one higher power or more than one. They might believe in male, female, non-binary, or genderless ideas of God. All kinds of things. Theists, atheists, or agnostics, any of them might believe in the goodness of human nature, human communities, the living ecosystem of the earth, and our ability to do good within all of these systems. And even once you think you've got those parts figured out, then you start thinking about how people, nature, and higher powers shape change in those systems. And when? And why? So, here's the thing about theologies and becoming. Remember how we've talked before about how we can explore a lot of different sources here, but there's not any one that we're required to believe in. I'm going to give you some fancy words for that. UUs believe revelation is not sealed. What the heck does that mean? Well, you know what sealed means, I bet. It means when something is shut, like an envelope. You can't open it anymore. And revelation is when something is revealed and you can suddenly see it. Like when you tell your parents your room is clean, but then they lift up your bedspread and surprise, there's a bunch of stuff under your bed. It's a whole new way of understanding your room and cleanliness. So the Torah, the Quran, the Bible, the Ramayana, science, they all came to be because one or more people said, hey, check it out. We found out something important about how things work. Look what was revealed to us. And of course, this is all very interesting to the rest of us as we try to figure out our place in the universe and why it all matters. Instead of picking one of these sources and saying, that's it, that's the one, everybody, we found it. UUs encourage each other to keep checking under our theological beds, in our theological closets, and out our theological windows. We're guided by our 7, maybe 8 someday, principles, but we explore the 6 sources in different ways. Here's one more way to look at this. Our high school youth have a phrase they use to describe how we should be together. They say, be a croissant, not a donut. You can see why right away. If a group of people are being a donut, they're in a circle, and the circle is closed. A croissant is always open at one spot so new people can get in. This is how UU theology is supposed to be. Theologically, we're croissants, not donuts. We always leave an opening so new revelations can get in. This is one way UUs are a people of becoming. Our theologies keep becoming throughout our lives. And you know what that means? Whether you're 8 or 87, it means you don't have to have all the answers right now. That's why we have faith formation for children, youth, and adults. That's why we have worship. To be honest, that's partly why we chat with each other in coffee hour. These places, they're our UU croissants. They're where we go to be a people of becoming. Because you never know who's going to show up in that open space and reveal an amazing idea. And grownups, I just want to remind you right here that an 8-year-old could be the prophetic voice you need right now. They do it to me all the time. So this month, take some time to yourself, maybe sit under a special tree like the Buddha did, and think about your theology a little bit. Ask yourself what has been revealed to you this year. Ask yourself, who am I becoming? And especially as we start to spend more time together outside and on the church grounds, let's be croissants so we don't miss a revelation. Thank you.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Apologies for some of the tech glitches this morning. I was having kind of an off morning with my two computers set up and the files weren't transferring correctly. But this morning, I'm so pleased to be with you this morning. We've done a couple interactions already on Adult Forum, and thank you for those that attended and for your contributions. It was a heavier topic than we've done in the past, and I appreciate all of that engagement. Greg, is there any way for you to reshare the screen? I have a slide that's coming up after the joys and concerns of some of the examples of Night Without a Bed. One of the things that I'd like to call your attention to this morning for our joys and concerns is the Night Without a Bed campaign for Family Promise. And we've done this in the past. And it is a way to raise awareness for our support for Family Promise's programs that help people experiencing homelessness, and particularly families experiencing homelessness. So take a look in the order of service about that information. There'll be a link for you to click so that you can join All Souls team to donate. But then also, if you're not in a position to donate, please do raise awareness on social media and in your own circles by getting other people to participate. Night Without a Bed is a way that we show solidarity. And it's also a good way to teach children about what it means to be homeless, and that homelessness is not always the stereotype that we see living under bridges, but it's also sometimes sleeping in your car or sleeping on a friend's couch or camping outside. And so Night Without a Bed asks all of us to spend one night, May 1st, not in our own beds. And so you can get as creative as you like. Last year, my son Elias built a little goblin house in our backyard, which is basically a stick hut with debris. And he slept out there. Sarah Cannon included a photograph of herself sleeping on the couch with an Afghan that she had made during RE sessions. So get as creative as you like and try to recruit as many people as you can to spread awareness for the campaign. We used to host Family Promise at the All Souls building. We used to host families quarterly, but now with COVID and we're unable to do that. So this is one of our ways that we are able to continue to support their endeavor. I know I've spoken about this before, but this is a cause that particularly touches my heart. I've talked about experiencing homelessness in the past for myself and my son, but also just the idea of unrootedness. As an immigrant who comes from a family with many nationalities, my father's from Afghanistan, my mom is Chinese Filipino, we moved a lot because of my father's Afghan political past. We were getting deported a lot because his passport was not acknowledged in some countries. And my earliest memory is being in a jail cell in Senegal, West Africa, and being 3 years old and not understanding how a person could be illegal and how my father was being deported from Senegal. And you might ask, what does this have to do with Family Promise? It has to do with Family Promise because the idea of rootedness, a home to come back to, a place to put down roots, is really, really important to preserving human dignity. And when I think back to my childhood of experiencing deportations and political instability, Family Promise is a cause I really believe in. I don't want any child to feel as unrooted as I did. And I thank you all for your generous support of that cause. Some of the other things are listed in the order of service. I particularly want to lift up Ron Keeper's wife, Sherry, who has had a knee replacement and she is undergoing physical therapy. So please do keep her in your thoughts and send good energy her way. Thank you.
We call upon the God of many names and no name at all, the great force that courses throughout the universe and the divine light which resides within us all. May we hold in our hearts all of those who are homeless, who are ill, who are alone, those who continue to suffer from the sorrow that this pandemic has wrought upon us. We ask for healing strength and energy to those who are recovering from illness, from surgery. We look forward to the time when families can once again be reunited, when those of us who call church our home can once again be physically there. We ask for our leaders to be given strength and courage to do what is right. We ask for continued love and support of all of those who we hold dear and near to us. For this we pray, Amen. There is a song that I remember from the disco era. And yes, I used to put on my dancing shoes, platform shoes, and go dancing on Friday and Saturday night. The song was called The Second Time Around. Some of you may know it, some of you may not. It was sung by a group called Shalimar. It was a love song, like so many songs are. And it was about, of course, how much better love was the second time around. I'm not sure how much of that is true, but how many things are there in life that when we try to get it right the first time, it just does not work? Our lives are replete with first times, and they are important to us, and some of them are quite magical. There's the first tooth, the first day of school, the first kiss, the first job, the firstborn, and in many societies, the firstborn son, and taking it all the way back to the beginning. The first time we drew breath. So many firsts. Some of them we engage with intention and some of them we do not. First times, no matter how we come upon them, are often difficult and fraught with anxiety, even when they are the ones we are joyfully anticipating. They are all a part of our becoming. And there's not often much that can help us with our first times because they are, well, first times. A first time can be a one-off event, or it can be a beginning. Just the start of many more firsts. From the welcome this morning, I see that you are in the middle of some things. You have started your pledge campaign, the search for a new minister. What you all hope, I am sure, will be the start of wonderful new things. But we know too that history is full of beginnings, first times that were not so wonderful, that did not go well, at least not for everyone. I'm a new resident in Virginia. I come from New York, but I've been learning a lot about the history there. And there's a state park very close to where I live in Virginia, and it's called First Landing. Back in 1607, the Discovery, the Susan Constant, and the Godspeed, three ships carrying more than 100 men and women from England, landed at a place now called Cape Henry, which is right next to the park. These people went on to establish the first permanent settlement in what some now call the New World, in a place we now call Jamestown. In the region surrounding the Chesapeake Bay, the place where this happened, in a place that had already been occupied by people often referred to by the same name. A first marking a beginning that was full of hope and promise for the English settlers was also an occasion marking the beginning of sorrow and destruction for the people they found there. In our own lives, whether or not we are starting something that could have significant impact, which that landing and others like it did, or something that could have personal sentimental value, something no less important to us, we want to get it right. What can help us with first times, with beginnings on the way to becoming? Planning, of course. There can never be enough planning for some of us. We also need to be adaptable. No matter what we may plan, there is always something that can happen to make the most well thought out plans folly. And the lessons that we are still learning that arose from those who thought they were here first shows us that perspective and compassion are everything when we are trying to figure out if what we are doing is right and if we have done it right. When we are engaging in first times with others, a business arrangement or even a marriage, we may value planning and adaptability, but we also need to be in agreement about what we are setting out to do. But perhaps more than anything, for first times, we need courage. Simply, sometimes we fear that we might not get it right the first time. And courage is needed because we may have to try it again. Some of our fears arise out of the belief that we might not be successful when we decide to follow our heart's desire. We are often just as much afraid of success in our endeavors as we are afraid of our failures. Because success in work or school or anywhere else for that matter, any of our relationships, any of our endeavors can mean change. Having courage sometimes means dealing with difficult situations, conflict at work or home, financial difficulties. Just existing from day to day can sometimes be a struggle. As you heard in the opening words this morning, sometimes just facing the day may present a courageous opportunity for some. Having courage sometimes means protecting and defending those who cannot do it for themselves. It means speaking up for what is right when you are the small voice in a large crowd, speaking up for what you know is right in the face of all that is wrong. We Unitarian Universalists pride ourselves on the work that we do on social justice issues. And our denomination has started many initiatives over the years. First for us, if you will, the wildly successful UU The Vote is one of them. Protecting immigrant rights, helping to feed the hungry, doing work to halt the destruction of our planet. This is holy work, but it is also courageous work. And for some of us, it involves doing this work for the first time. Having courage means being willing to embrace change. Change is one of the most difficult things that can happen to us. And every first, no matter how large or small, brings with it change. Having courage means being able to face the unchangeable or the uncertainty that presents itself in the face of accidents, serious illness, and even death. This pandemic, because all of these sometimes unstoppable events cause everything that happens after them to be thought of as the first time since. And for some of us, just waking up to the first light of another day requires courage. None of this is easy. All of it requires preparation. The fortification, if you will. So, what can we do to prepare our hearts to be courageous? Where do we get the strength to be courageous? Well, some of us get it from within. There are myriad spiritual practices that you can engage in to center you, to keep you focused, to help you get over your fears, to do that new and first thing. There are books and courses and workshops and conferences aimed at helping us to become our most courageous selves. Personally, I like to pray and ask for inner strength and courage. And sometimes I find it myself doing it more frequently than I would have expected. But we also need to get strength from without. One of the things that really prepares our hearts so that we can live courageously and embrace all of the first times is the love that we feel for each other and the world. That moves us into being and action. And the love and support that we get in return from our families, whether or not we define them by blood, from our friends and from those who mean the most to us in our lives, and from the people here in this community. For you, I'm talking about the people of All Souls. If we were in a building, I would say, look around you. But We're here in Zoom and some of us are on Facebook. You can maybe see who's engaged there, but if you're here in the Zoom room and if you're not looking at the gallery view, take the time to switch to that view if you know how to do that. This is your community. And these are the people from whom you can draw courage. And the covenant which you lifted up this morning acknowledges the help you are to give to one another. Church can mean different things to different people. But unlike the family you are born into, we are a self-selected group. As you use, we have no religious creed that binds us together. Our desire to be in pursuit of a liberal faith gives us freedom from that. And we heard all about what's under the bed during the time for all ages. The simple fact that we are here together means each one of us has chosen not to embrace some things alone. Even if it's just a spiritual journey, even if only for an hour this morning. Whatever we get by being here together, we cannot forget that we are also called upon to give something to. And all of these things are what give us the courage, not necessarily to run into a burning building or to stop a bullet, although it might, but to get through the everyday and sometimes extraordinary trials we have to face as a part of normal living. To take the initiative, to help the homeless, to feed the hungry. The list is endless. Just knowing someone is there for you can give you the courage to do and to overcome just about everything. But sometimes courage is not about giving up and starting over. Courage is about taking what you have already begun and doing what you can to make it work. Because starting over is not always a luxury that we have. Even if the first time, the beginning, in retrospect, was not as perfect as we would have liked it to have been. As for us Unitarian Universalists, next month is the 60th anniversary of a first time that is responsible for many of us being here today, and I'm willing to bet that some of you may recall that, the merger of the American Unitarian Association and the Universalist Church of America. And some of you who have been through with us throughout that long history can testify to the fact that it has sometimes been a rocky road since then too. But we are still working on it. We are still trying to get it right. There is so much about the seven principles of Unitarian Universalism that tell us how we should not only face the first times in our lives, but each and every moment. At Seaview, that's what we call it, Coastal Virginia Unitarian Universalists, the congregation where I am the minister, we have also adopted the eighth principle of Unitarian Universalism, which calls us to journey toward spiritual wholeness by working to build a diverse, multicultural, beloved community by our actions that accountably dismantle racism and other oppressions in ourselves and our institution. Our liberal faith is life-affirming, but it can also be life-changing, not only for us, but for all of the people around us, if we live out our liberal faith as guided by our principles. And as I close today, I ask you to reflect on how different would that first time over four centuries ago have been if the men and women coming to these shores from Europe had not only the courage to make that ocean journey, but these 8 principles to guide them. In this nation, how different would all the years that have followed since then been? How different would today have been? And how different could today and tomorrow be if we continue to work on it, to make it right? Amen, and blessed be.
Good morning again, everyone. There are so many ways to be a people of becoming at All Souls. And so what I'd like to do now is to draw your attention to our weekly connection card link right here in the chat. And I wanted to call your attention to a couple of different items that might be of interest to you as you think about how we can be a people of becoming. One way is to continue our adult faith formation exploration by volunteering to lead an adult forum. There's also a socially distant meditation group that I know was quite popular in the fall that is back now that the weather has warmed. And so you could sign up to participate in that. That meets on Mondays. And also, if you are interested in helping our church and our church grounds become more what we dream that they can be, there's wonderful work to be done in the beautiful butterfly garden outside our atrium area. And the new trees that we put in and dedicated last fall are entering the season of needing to be watered again. So if you would please take a moment to fill out the connection card now, we would be very grateful. Thank you.
Every week, we share the plate offering with an organization that shares our values. This week, half of the offertoria will be contributed to the Unitarian Universalist Society for Ministerial Relief. This organization provides assistance to retired UU ministers, as well as support to surviving spouses and children of deceased ministers. The link to contribute is on your screen. At this time, let us thankfully accept the morning offering.
Cheap, fake, easy to break. That's how I used to be. Here, take it. Now I'm awake. I'll tell you what I see. Plastic don't shine, glitter don't shine, rhinestones don't shine the way you do. You are so real, you are so rare. I see you there, I see you.
We knew how strong we were.
We are always in a season of beginning and becoming. With each and every moment of our lives, we are in the space of starting over and working to make a difference. May we embrace and rejoice in whatever changes and chances come our way. And may we grow from that. And may we, with courage, live into the gifts that gives to us. Ashe, amen, and blessed be.
Good morning, all. Just a few quick reminders before coffee hour. Meditation group meets on Monday nights at the All Souls Lawn. So do bring a mask and bring something to sit on. Eric Rose is sort of changing the, format of that group, and he's going to talk about that for a second. Greg, can you highlight Eric Rose for a minute?
Yeah, I'm just looking for him. There he is.
Good morning, everyone. My name's Eric Morrows. My wife, Yuko, and I are members of All Souls. I want to invite everybody to join our socially distanced meditation group, which meets every Monday at 6:30 p.m. Beginning on May 3rd, we'll be following the guided meditations that are found in Tara Brach's book called Radical Acceptance, Embracing Your Life with the Heart of a Buddha. Dr. Brach is a trained therapist and Zen Buddhist teacher. Her thesis is that everyone suffers from self-doubt, and that self-doubt is a profound suffering. Her solution is radical self-acceptance as a path to freedom. The book is 12 chapters, so beginning on May 3rd, we'll focus on one chapter in guided meditation per week. While not required to join in the weekly meditation, you may find it helpful to purchase the book. We'll be providing links for you to do so. And please let either me or Nasreen know if you need assistance with that. Again, we meet every Monday, weather permitting, at 6:30 in front of the church. Beginners and first timers are always welcome, and I hope to see you then. Thank you.
Okay, everybody, we're gonna open up the breakout rooms now. Thank you for joining us today. Reverend Viola will be dropping in to say hello to different rooms, so that's great. Give me just 1 second to get those going for you. All right, those are open for you to enjoy. Thank you so much.